me decided to submit a paper. We said this topic, error estimation, is a good topic for an interactive session. We can discuss with people who are interested, but the organizing committee has decided to make out an oral talk, so I try to convince you that error estimation in general is very important. So probably most of you were sometimes forced to do voluntarily some psychovisual tests, like a pair comparison test. Typically for gamut mapping is the question is, what is the better representation of an original image? We could also think of other tests. What is the more pleasing image if you want to improve the smile of the people? For example, for a camera, camera maker. And then what's the result? In general, you get, we go back to a gamut mapping study. Here we have two gamut mapping studies. You have What's the pointer? So on the left side, you have a gamut mapping. You have two gamut mapping studies. They look from the quality quite similar, have the same scale. And you may ask the question, for example, if gamut mapping 1 is better than gamut mapping 4, it seems to be. Maybe 2 is worse than 3. What is important that you have some confidence interval. And here I have now calculate the confidence interval, and you see now the difference. On the left, we have a published study with 20 observers, 50 images, and on the right, I just simulated a study with 2 observers, 4 images, with equal scales. So you see that error estimation or the confidence interval has to be part of the evaluation. Now I introduce 2 important numbers for those studies, the number of stimuli, small n, and the number of comparison in capital N. On the left, the difference is that a capital N is much larger than on the right side. So why do we need an accurate error estimation? For example, if the error estimation is too small, a result may be classified wrongly as significant. Or if the error estimation is too large, it may lead to wrong conclusions in chi-square tests. For example, a test where whether 2 data sets are from the same population may fail. Or also in the test design, if you know what's the error estimation, you can estimate how many comparisons do I need for a desired accuracy. Now we just summarize Thurston's law of comparative judgment. The study is, so we have a data collection. The respondents compare pairs of items. And usually we have a frequency matrix Fij of the stimuli I being preferred over stimulus J, where the sum of Fij and Fji is usually n. And then here in this study we restrict to the Thurston case 5. The assumptions here are that we have uncorrelated scale values, that they are normally distributed, and they have equal variance for each stimuli. And then we can estimate the probability that the item Y is preferred over J. That is just the area under the normal Gauss curve. So it's the cumulative normal distribution. So the solution now, I have to do some mathematics to get the error estimations later, that we approximate this proportion by the proportion values, or also called percentage values, and we add a small bias to avoid singularity. This is only important if the frequencies are small. then we arrive to a set mod matrix using the inverse cumulative normal distribution. Here it's interesting to note that this matrix is anti-symmetric. And finally, we add up the rows of the matrix and scale it correctly. Now we go to the error estimation part. Here I introduce just three important laws of error propagation. There are only a few of them we will need later. So if you have a value x with a standard deviation sigma x, and we scale the value, the standard deviation is also scaled by c. If I have a function of a variable, then the sigma is scaled by the derivative of this function. Here we assume that higher derivatives can be neglected. And if we have sums of independent values, if we have a series of x, 1 to xn, with standard deviation sigma x to sigma xn, then the error goes with the square of the sigmas, and then the sum of the squares of the sigmas with the square root. Now we go back to the Thurston case 5. We start with, like, from the statistics, from a Bernoulli variable with n trials, and the standard deviation of p is then this formula, square root of pyj times minus 1 of pyj over n, and taking the square root. And now we approximate p by q, and the error is just by substitution the error of the qij is given by this formula. And now, if you go to the set matrix, we have a function of a variable, we do error propagation. Then in the next step, to get the scale values, we have sum of variables and scales, and we end up now with our first error estimation formula. Note that this error here is dependent on the stimulus I. I call it the individual error. Now we can make an approximation out of it. If all probabilities Qij are not far from 1/2, then the error of Q is about constant. And similarly, the error of the C values is also constant. And we go further with error propagation, and we get a second error estimation, which is now independent of the stimulus, which is 1 over n times the square root of pi times n minus 1 over capital N. I call it the approximate error. And note here that this is proportional to 1 over square root of capital N and 1 over square root of the number of stimuli. Now let's go back to other error estimations. That was actually the topic why we made this study, because it's contradictory. In Morovic's thesis, Morovic gives a confidence interval which goes, and if we set the correct sigma, we get an error estimation of the square root of 1 over 2 times large n. I must say that it's not quite clear what kind of interpretation to make in the thesis, but this formula was used in several studies, later studies, and cited by people doing certain tests. Then, about 80 years later, Montag saw this problem, and he made simulations, and he found an empirical formula where he fitted these five values. And now we compare it with our approximate error. And here we see the first error estimation is only dependent on the number of observations and independent on the number of stimuli. Montag's formula is more or less proportional to 1 over square root of capital N and also more or less to 1/√ of the number of stimuli. And the same result we get for our approximate error. Now there, I introduce now a fourth error estimation. Like if you do the, if you calculate the scale values from an experiment, here I have different color means different images, different shape means different observers. And what I can do is now from the data set put it into m groups with random comparison, and for each group calculate the scale values, and then take the standard deviation of those VAJ for all different J's, and I can extract the experimental error of the scale values VE by scaling this sigma correctly. And then one can do this this experiment several times and then average and get a good experimental error estimate. We use now this error estimation and we make simulation based on choice data produced on assuming exact case 5 conditions. So we make now three experiments. The first experiment is to test the approximate error estimation. We have small scale values, smaller than 1/4. We use different number of stimuli and a whole range of number of observations, make 10,000 repetitions. This is now the raw data. What we see here, I used two different types of this bias just to see what's the influence of the of this bias, and we see as soon as the number of observations is large enough, it doesn't depend what kind of small number I use. Now we use, if you calculate Morawiec's formula, we see it's always overestimating the errors, except it's about at the place where a small n would be 3. Now Montag's formula gives quite good approximation, and also the same is true for the approximate error. We see here now it's just the difference is as big as the choice of what kind of bias I use. Then the second experiment is now to test where do we need or why do we need an individual error estimation. We use now equally spaced scale values in the interval of -1 to 1, and we use a large number of n to omit the influence of the bias and make again 10,000 repetitions. Now here we see the simulated data. We see now that scale values, which for larger scale values, the individual error rises on both sides. If you use the approximate error for clear, we have it's constant, so it's always a lower limit of the simulated error. If you use the individual error, it fits quite well. It starts to get small deviations for quite large scale values. In the third experiment, it's just a wrap up. I use now here scale values from -2 to 2 and number of observations from 2 to 100, and I just compare all four estimations. Now for n equals 3, Morawiec's formula is still quite good here. White means that the estimated deviation is smaller than 10%. That's good. Gray is between 10 and 20%, may also be acceptable. And black is the error estimation is not accurate. Is less accurate than 20%. Now for n equal 5 or 8, we see now that the first formula doesn't fit any more, that Montag's formula and the approximate error are quite similar, and they always have a limit, like up to a scale value of about, scale value difference of about 1, it's accurate enough. And for the individual error, like if you have a study with large differences in scale values, you see that it's much more accurate, especially if you go to high number of observations. In conclusion, error estimation using error propagation has two advantages. One is it's the most accurate, I presented here, and it's also adaptable to other models. Like if I use a logistic, a Bradley-Terry model, it can be derived in the same, in the analog way. And recommendations is like, if I know I have small scale values, the approximate error estimation, either the one in the paper or the one by Montag is acceptable. But for large scale values, we should go for two individual error estimations. Thank you for your attention.
Questions? I have one. Have you tried using non-parametric resampling methods instead?
Non-parametric?
So you simply resample your source data.
I think it would give the same result.
Well, perhaps.
Perhaps. Or you say resample it like n times, and then you know how many. I think it's equivalent.
Well, not exactly, in the sense you've made some parametric assumptions about the distributions. You've assumed a binomial distribution with a binomial variance, and you've assumed implicitly a normal approximation to a binomial. So all those assumptions could be uncertain.
Yes. Like the study is, like I assume a model, and with the sort of experimental error, I can reproduce this error exactly.
And
it's clear that any study has some other influences, like the case 5 assumptions may be wrong. Like for this, there are tests like Mostella tests. And then it's also clear that the error estimation, like if I know what's different, I can make an error estimation based on that.
In which case, thank you, Peter.